a couple weeks ago, and he asked me, he said, "Would you come back to Big House?" We're in the middle of a series called Grind. So he's telling me about Grind and everything that's going on and kind of the progression that he's taken everybody in and where his heart is, which, one, I had to laugh. I'm going to give you a little insight. PJ does not like acronyms. So the fact that you're in the middle of a series called Grind is just an irony upon ironies. That's like him going to the beach. I was talking to Jared this morning. Every time he's at the beach, I never see a picture with the guy in a swimming suit. Got to give him a hard time about that. So he's telling me about all this stuff. He says, you're going to be resistance. That's resistance, R. God first, resistance is second. And I'm going to give you a little insight in the life of me, okay? This isn't all pastors probably, but the life of me, okay? He says that, and the first thing I think of is, I've been working on this other message that I've got mostly prepared right now. I'm going to go with that, because why? Because you want to look good when you come in and show up, right? It's kind of like a date, or you're going to prom or something. You get all dolled up, and they take pictures, and you roll in, you look good, and you feel good, all that stuff. So now, the reality is I would say most pastors are that way, too. I don't know if you realize this or not. We're people. I'm a person, too. If I was a pastor, and people didn't show up, it isn't going to be very long, and I'm not going to have a church, and I'm going to have to go do something else, right? So at the end of the day, you want people to care and like and feel like God's done something in their life to keep showing up. So my thought is go with the easy slam dunk, right? Slam dunk? That's what I was thinking. I used to be able to slam dunk. I could do it until I was 35. Not anymore. 41 has taken me down a notch or two. But a week into it, and I cannot get the word resistance out of my mind. I can't, I'm trying to push it to the side. But I can't get it to escape my mind of where you guys are at. And I'm like, Lord, what do you want to do? And it literally was a grind for me. I said, Lord, okay, you want me to preach on resistance? I take the step, I text PJ, I say, PJ, I'm in for resistance, let's rock this thing. I had no idea what I was going to talk about. No idea. I had no idea what God wanted to share with you. I say, God, I get on my knees. That's what it does. You know what I'm saying? When you're in a place of desperation, dear Lord. You get on your knees quick. You get on my knees. I'm like, Lord, what are you wanting me to do? And slowly, piece by piece, by piece, he put this picture of resistance together for me that we're going to talk about here in just a minute. This is what I realized. Resistance is everywhere. And when I say everywhere, I mean everywhere. You don't go to the bathroom without a little resistance. Think about that for a second. Yeah, it took you. Look at now, 2 seconds later, there was resistance on that joke. It's the truth, though. You don't do anything without resistance. If I take this bottle of water and I roll it across the stage right here, resistance is what's going to stop that thing from continuing to roll. And most of us in life, we run from resistance. I do. When it comes to exercise, I run. When it comes to just things getting hard, what do I want to do? I want to run, and I want to go the exact opposite way of everything that has to do with resistance in my life, because why? I want it easy. I want the armchair life with my feet kicked up, with a cold drink sitting next to me, watching my favorite show, with everything right. My kids grow up to be perfect. They do all the things that they're supposed to do. They love me to the ends of the earth and back. My wife is amazing and beautiful, which she is. But all those things, that's what you want. Every one of us wants that kind of life. And if you don't, we're in the wrong room together, because the reality is I don't want any resistance. I roll out to my car. When I turn the ignition, I want it to start. Everybody runs from resistance. Throw that first picture up here for you guys. I got a little picture about resistance for you. Here's a guy, nice looking guy, huh? He looks good. Could be a girl, it doesn't matter. Kind of nice looking. One of those moments, right? Selfie moment. Now, I don't use this. I got long arms, so I don't need a selfie stick. But, you know, a selfie stick. And I'm new to this whole selfie thing, but I'm realizing the reason that you do the down angle is so you look better. Right? It's a selfie stick moment right there. You throw that thing up. If you go like this, you look big. You go like this, you look thin. It's like muy bonita. Right? That's what you want, a selfie moment. But the reality is, give me the next one. This is the reality of life. He's sitting here all happy and excited, right? The reality is that I'm sitting there smiling in my car thinking I'm going to catch a wave, and the reality is the world around me is ready to wipe me out. Resistance. Now, I have a lot of people who ask me what my favorite verse is. They'll say, oh, what's your favorite Bible verse and this and that. And, you know, there's some ones that stick out along the way that are important to me. But I'm realizing the older I get that God takes me through seasons. Takes me through seasons in life. And at different times, there's different parts of the Bible that just grab me and they hold on to me. And I've been that way with the story of Joseph for the last probably year. I've been stuck in it. I keep reading it over and over. I can't shake it. Like, it's just been there. I don't know what God's exactly trying to tell me, but every time I read it, he speaks something to my heart. And that's been a story that I've been clinging to. Now, as a pastor, you hope. Now, this is a trick. Like, you don't want... Now, if I speak out of line, that's my reality, you know? My reality is if I give you something that's stupid, it's like that. Like, the bomb is waiting to come. The reality is I don't want to put things into the Bible. I want to take them out. I don't want to put my ideas or my thoughts or my this's and that's. But at the same time, I want to share the truth that happens around us in life. And that's where this is. As I'm going, I'm like, Lord, I don't want to put something into this, but this seems to fit. It seems to make sense. And I want to walk you through this with me. Now, I'm going to give you a little assignment, okay? You all right? Who will go with an assignment? Okay, I have a couple. They're like, resistance. Lame. Resistance. A lot of times we read Bible together in church, and I like that. It's important. We're going to read a little bit right now. But I want you to go home and read this story. Starts in Genesis 37. So don't worry about pulling out your Bibles right now. Genesis 37, it's easy to remember. Many of you can remember where you're at when 37. If you're not 37 yet, 37. It's not that hard to remember. Genesis 37, first book, open it up, story of Joseph. Here it is in a paraphrased version. Young man, 17 years old. He's loved by his father, the Bible says, more than all of his brothers. He has a big family. Loved by his father more than all of his other brothers. Resistance. Right? I don't know if you're part of... I just got one brother, but I tell you what, I'd be mad as anything if my brother was loved by my dad more than me. Right? Resistance. You better believe his brothers were not happy with him. They didn't like it. I wouldn't like it if that's how I felt about my family. If I felt like my brother was loved by my dad, I'd be mad. Resistance. Then he gets a dream, right? He has this dream. He ends up having two dreams, and after he has a dream, he goes and does what? Like an unwise young brother, he rolls up and tells his brothers what his dream was. And they got what? Mad, right? Got mad. Resistance. Then he has another dream and the same thing. He didn't learn his lesson from the first time. And so he goes and tells him again. And he has resistance. Now let's back that story up to the beginning, okay? Let's start over. Jacob has a bunch of kids, and he loves his son, his youngest son, more than all the rest of them. Loves him more. As a dad, there's resistance. All the brothers know that their dad loves their youngest brother more, but they still are doing the family business. They're still doing the things that God they were supposed to do from their dad and all that stuff, but there's resistance as brothers. You better believe there's hurt in their heart. Now, it's easy to jump into Joseph's side right now and say, man, that guy's got a lot of resistance. He does, and we're going to continue to follow him. But there's resistance there on the brother's side, too, because all of a sudden they're saying, look at him. He's favored. Dad gives him a cool coat. He does all this stuff for him. They're loved. Where do we fit in this picture? They're feeling resistance. Now, it's easy for us to jump in and automatically think, oh, there's resistance. When I'm telling my story, you better believe everybody knows the resistance that I'm feeling. That's the way we are in human nature. We make our side look beautiful, right? But the truth of the matter is resistance is happening all the time in every direction. Dad says to Joseph, he says, hey, your brothers are out tending the sheep. I need you to go out and check on them. Whoo, resistance. I'd be resisting that thing. Are you kidding me? I already know that you love me more. They're already mad at me for these dreams that I got. Now you're asking me to go out and make sure they're doing what they're supposed to be doing? Are you kidding me? Resistance. But he does it. When he gets there, the brothers see him and they say, there's that traitor over there. What am I doing? Let's get rid of him because Dad likes him more. Let's get him out of our hair so we don't have to deal with it. But you got to know on the back of their mind there's resistance. They don't want to do that. But they don't know what else to do because all of a sudden he's loved more. He's loved more. Right? Than everybody else. So they grab him, throw him in a pit while they meeting of the minds. You better believe there was resistance in that meeting. They end up selling him. They end up selling him for 20 shekels. 20 shekels. Resistance. The people that bought him, resistance. They take him to Egypt, resistance. When they get there, they got to sell him. There's resistance in that. He gets hired by a guy who does good. Now, here's an interesting thing, because most people don't think about this, but the Bible says in Genesis 39, it talks about Joseph being handsome. Handsome, that's the exact word. So I mean, he's probably better looking. We don't got that guy up there, but he's probably better looking than that guy, okay? He's a good looking guy. Washboard abs, toned. Got tan skin, you know. He's a good looking guy. And Potiphar's wife, it says, set her eyes towards him. That she would have him. Now, you never thought about it, but your looks could be resistance. There's resistance in a lot of different places in our lives that we don't recognize and we don't understand, but we just kind of keep going. And because we fight resistance, a lot of times we're fighting against where God's trying to take us and what he's trying to do. Now, I understand what I'm saying is a whole new thought because it rocked my world as I've spent the last week fighting through trying to figure what this is. But the reality is we have resistance in every area of our lives. And most of us spend our lives running from the very thing that's going to be there no matter what we do. You telling me my looks can be resistance? Absolutely. Your looks can be resistance. Your job can be resistance. Your family can be resistance. All these things that are happening in our lives can be resistance. And they put us in this bigger picture called the grind. And we're trying to figure out how to get through it, right? At the end of the day, that's what I want to know. How do I get through it? How do I make it to the other side? And the answer that we're all looking for is this. It's a lazy boy with a drink sitting next to me, nice and cold. With my favorite television program. And all the things that I want are stacked next to me. Wrong. That's the biggest load of doohickey I've ever heard. It ain't gonna work like that. Your life ain't gonna work like that. The way you live ain't gonna work like that. Everything that matters in your life is going to be built around resistance. Everything. I read this book not too long ago, and I wasn't planning on sharing this, but it just fits. It fits for you. And I need you to understand where we're going with resistance to make this stick, to make it something that you can lead with and actually change your life, because that's the goal of all this. You may not think that, but the goal is to move one step closer to the Lord so that I live a little bit more like Him, so that I function a little bit more like Him, so that my cares and my desires are a little bit closer to His, so that despite all the other stuff, when I go out, I bring glory to Him. That's the goal of all this. So I read this book. Now, perfect pitch. I don't know if you've ever heard of that concept, but perfect pitch is this. It's I can hear a note on any instrument, and I know immediately what that note is. Mozart had it. That's what made him so amazing. At a young age, he had perfect pitch. Up until about 30 years ago, the amount of people who had perfect pitch were 1 in 10,000. 1 in 10,000, okay? So one person out of every 10,000 had perfect pitch. And the prevailing thought was this. You either got it or you don't got it. And it's something that happens. You're born with it. So these guys set out, you know, they said, well, let's see if this is true, okay? Let's see if this is accurate and true. And so they took a class of, and I want to say it was 30, it might have been 50, I can't remember the exact numbers because I wasn't planning on going this way. But they took this class of about 30 kids, little kids. They said, let's put them through 2 years of intense training. Help them with music at a young age to get good. At the end of the class, what do you think happened? Every one of those kids had perfect pitch. That study destroyed the thought of you either have perfect pitch or don't have perfect pitch. Now, where does that fit with us in resistance? It fits right here. Let me explain this to you. You can do just about anything that you put your heart and mind to. But the truth of it is there's going to be resistance in your life, and you're going to have to be willing to roll through it. You say, Jeremy, I want to get up here and speak. I want to be like PJ, or I want to be like this, or I want to do this part of thing, or I want to build this, or grow here, or do this. It doesn't matter what it is that you fill that blank in with. If you're willing to put in the work and to do what you need to do, you can become it. The same is true when we sit in here and say, God, I want to be a good follower of you. You know, when PJ gets up here and says, you need to do this, or come to Thursday nights, or we got Saturday nights going on, and you know what? The reality is there's going to be resistance. But if I'm going to grow closer to the Lord, and I'm going to walk with Him, and I'm going to be closer and more like Him, don't you think I need to learn a little bit more about Him? I've been studying. This is my 42nd birthday coming up this summer. Now, most people say 40, whatever, blah, blah, blah. 40 was lame. 42 is my most important birthday, and I'm going to explain why. This summer is going to come. My most important birthday in my life is coming up this summer at 42. I was 21 years old when I gave my life to the Lord. I spent 21 years living like a dog heathen. And at 42, I will have spent the equal amount of time living as best I can for the Lord. And so for the first time in my life, I will equal that point. But you better believe, my son the other morning was saying, Dad, I don't want to go to school. I hate school. I hate school. I hear that fairly often in the mornings, usually. I said, son, well, the reality is your dad spent 22 years in school. 22 years, I counted them all up. 22 flipping years, are you kidding? That's a long time. You don't just get to do something like that. The life we live in, the walk that we walk in, is not about some magic walk down to the corner, Circle K, buy a lottery ticket and hit it rich kind of thing. It's about resistance. When we come to Christianity, that's how we live our life. We live like we want to buy a lottery ticket. Woo! I gave my life to the Lord. Woo! 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 Okay, I want to speak to thousands, Lord. What do you got to say? Have you spent any time studying about Him, learning about Him, understanding who He is? Have you been able to communicate the truths in a way? That's the way we live. We live like it should just happen like that, and then we get pissy when it doesn't, right?
Come on. Come on.
It's the truth. We get pissy because all of a sudden it doesn't happen the way we want. Lord, you didn't give me that. I prayed one time down at the altar, and it should have happened just the way I wanted to. Look at this story. Read Genesis 37, man. The guy spent years of resistance before his dream happened. Years. We're talking 20 plus years. And you want to happen like that? Well, I gave my tithe and offering and God didn't bless me 100-fold. What in the heck? Are you kidding me? We are in a grind. Not only a grind, but we're in the grind of our lives. There is a world going to hell all around us. Oh, just turn on the news, man. Are you kidding me? There is a world going to hell all around us, and we have an answer, and we live like a bunch of spoiled brats.
Come on.
We want it our way. We want it to happen the way we want. We want everything to roll out the way we want. We want to sit in our little lazy boy recliner and do everything we want. And the whole time, God is saying, you know what? There's going to be a little resistance. There's going to be a little resistance. Kick up that last photo for me, would you? Now, I know this may not be appealing to everybody, but the thought of it is a good thought. At the end of our days, we want our life, at least I do, I want my life to count for something. When I'm laying in a pine box, and people come to say, hey, this is about Jeremy or whatever, I want my life to have mattered. I want it to make a difference in people's lives. I don't care if anybody's sitting out there, but at the end of my days, if somebody thinks, you know what, that he made my life a little bit better, that would be good for me. That'd be good for me. Life is about taking risks. Taking the jump. When I gave my life to the Lord just about 21 years ago, I couldn't have told you I'd be standing here today. I couldn't have told you it was a jump. It was a giant jump, faith. Every one of us is facing giant jumps in one way or another, whether it's personal, emotional, physical. There's all sorts of jumps that we are confronted with, but the biggest one, the biggest jump that we have is to say yes to the Lord and say, yes, I'm going to do what you asked me to do. And I'm telling you, it's full of crazy risk. And in the middle of all that, and I know this is so appealing since we all want to be in that lazy boy, in the middle of all that, there's going to be some resistance, right? There's going to be some resistance. But if you let that resistance help shape you into the person that God wants you to be, I can promise you this, that jump isn't going to be so bad. It's going to be a jump that's not only worth it, it's going to be a jump that's full of adventure. You say, well, I may not go overseas and preach and blah, 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 do this or that. You know what? You may never. But those jumps happen in my life every day when I get up and choose to have the right attitude. or to handle somebody the way that they should be handled rather than just blowing up at them and getting mad at them or doing the things the way that I want to do. It's about taking those jumps in little moments when I can change a person's life and affect them for good rather than just blow up at them or do something. It's little jumps when I watch a person stand on the corner and although I may not have a lot of money in my pocket, I pull a buck out or $2 out and help them out or I do this. You know, it's not about any one particular thing. It's about taking that jump one after another, after another, after another, and letting the resistance make me the person that God wants me to be.
Amen.
Resistance is there to define you. And I'm going to tell you this right now. The greater the calling, the greater the resistance that you're going to have in your life. You say, God spoke to me. You know what? I believe he did. But you better believe the greater the calling that he's placed in your life, the greater the resistance you're going to have to fight through to get there. Because I look at story. It wasn't just Joseph. I went through all sorts of stories throughout the Bible. Story after story after story of men and women facing resistance to what? Become the people that God had intended them to be. Now this place, this is a house, like family. I feel like I'm with family when I'm in here. That's what I love about this place. This place's dream is to grow up like giant killers, right? Women who are armed and dangerous, right? All the women are like, yeah, I'm packing right now. I'm just gonna tell you right now. You will never be armed and dangerous. You will never be a giant killer without resistance in your life.
Come on.
It ain't going to happen. So you better set it in your heart now. Set it in your heart now and say, I'm willing to push through and do the things that I need to do to be the person that God wants me to be. Now let me read you this verse. It's in John 15. It says this, it says, I am the true vine. This is God talking, or Jesus. And my Father is the vine dresser. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. And every branch that does not bear fruit, he prunes, that it may bear more fruit.
Amen.
Resistance is a reality. Resistance is not your enemy, it's your friend. Resistance is a truth in every one of our lives. Resistance is really the definer of who you will become if you're willing to push through it or not. Resistance at the end of all of it is incredibly important. And although it may be a grind while you're facing resistance, if you're willing to push through resistance, the grind is going to drop away and it'll be just like that guy jumping. It's going to be full of adventure. Life will be full of adventure. We'll look at one more verse because I just want you guys to see this. It's at the end of Genesis. So you can read all the way from 37 to the end. It's a great story. And what happens is this in Genesis chapter 50, in verse 20, is Joseph has gone through all of his life, and I didn't even go through all the things. There's a lot of points of resistance that we could have talked about. He's gone all the way through. He's faced resistance, 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 resistance. He ends up being promoted to the number two in command of all of Egypt. This is big time. Like, it's a jump from a boy trapped in a cave with some crazy dreams to his number two in control of the most powerful nation at that time in the world. And his family comes back. And there's resistance because he wants to see what happens. But he ends up saving his entire family and bringing them all to Egypt because there's a drought, all this stuff. There's resistance right there, hey? Resistance again. What did I tell you? Who knows what that was? That was like a sound system passing gas. That's what it was. And we're just going to blame it on that. Resistance, man. He's gone through all sorts of ups and downs and crazy turns. And he gets to the end, and he had brought his entire family there. He's restored with his father, Jacob. As Jacob, his father, blesses his sons, he passes away. And his brothers get together in chapter 50. And they feel resistance. They're scared. Why are they scared? They're scared because their dad is gone now to protect them, and they're afraid that Joseph will come back after them. After all these years, after everything that happened, they're afraid that he's going to come back after them and take them out now that their dad is gone. That's the bottom line. And Joseph says this in chapter 20. He says, "As for you, you meant evil for me. You meant evil for me. But God meant it for good, to bring it about that many people should be kept alive as they are today." We look at resistance. We look at resistance as the enemy most of the time. The truth of the matter is resistance is a definer in our life. And if you're willing to push through it, the sky's the limit as to what you can do for the Lord, what you can be in your own life. But it starts today. It starts simply today. Don't cue up any music right now, okay, guys? Just let it be. See, we set music to set the tone, set the mood. It's like a good love song when you got your girl next to you. It sets the mood. But the reality is we shouldn't need a mood setter to respond to what God needs us or wants us to do. That's the truth of the matter. Every one of us, at the end of the day, this is one of those messages, like most messages are, that every one of us could respond to, probably needs to respond to. Every one of us is facing resistance in one way or another. The choice is yours. This is going to be a good one for you. The choice is yours as to how you're going to respond to that resistance. Are you going to fight against it? Try and keep rolling. Try and keep going. Just kind of pass it by. Run from it a little bit. It's like this. Here's a good example. It's like if I got a thorn in my arm. What's the smart thing to do? Take the resistance and pull it out, right? That's a smart thing. Or a bee sting. We'll use bee sting for that. Let's say I get stung by a bee. I got a beehive in here. It comes down and gets me on the arm. The smart thing says go through the resistance and pull it out, right? Most of us live our lives, though, completely opposite of that bee sting. Most of us live our lives like this. I get a bee sting, so what do? I protect my arm so no one touches it. When I go to bed, I figure out a way because I'm afraid I'm going to roll onto it. And instead of going through the resistance that I need to go through so that I can get better or get to the other side, I set up all sort of little barriers to try and protect that bee sting right in my arm. Right? We do it with hurts. We do it with how we respond to people, with our spouses, with loved ones, friends, family. The list goes on. And we just continue living, trying to do everything that we can just to leave that little stinger right there. He's so good. I like him. And the whole time, the truth of the matter is I just need to grab a hold of that stinking thing and pull it out. And yeah, it's going to hurt like the dickens for a little bit, but it'll be better on the end. The same is true about all the things that we're facing in life. I don't know what they are. I couldn't tell you right now, but you do. And the truth of the matter is I guarantee, because I know how the Holy Spirit works, anytime you get into a setting like this and God starts plucking on hearts and working in them, he's trying to get you to see where he's trying to take you and what he wants to do with you. He's touching on areas, and you push back. Oh, I don't want to go there, Lord. That's ugly. What? He's trying to get us to wake up. He's trying to get us to wake up so that we can be giant killers. Lord, resistance is hard. It's really hard, Lord. And I run from it, just even in my own life, Lord. I run and I do not want to go down that road. But at the end of the day, I know that just like myself, my brothers and sisters who are sitting here right now need to face the resistance that they're dealing with in their lives. I pray today, without all the pomp and circumstance and craziness that goes on, I pray today that we'd look deep. We'd look deep. And we'd see the areas that we need to push through in. The areas that you are trying to create in us something that is good and amazing and wonderful, the kind of thing that only you can create, and that we push past all the stupid resistance, and we push past all that resistance, and we'd say, I'm going to fight through because you're worth it, Lord, and the plan that you have for me at the other side is unbelievable. And that we would take that unbelievable jump and say, Lord, I trust you. I trust you, Lord. And that we would let resistance not become our enemy, but it would become the very thing that propels us into the plans that you have for us, Lord. I pray all of this in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.